بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وبين السعين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن شاء الله today I'm going to extend the time more than the 15 minutes in order to compensate for the glitch of the internet yesterday. We'll try إن شاء الله over the next 25 or 30 minutes to cover six surahs. The first surah is Surah Al-Qasas. And we started speaking about that yesterday, but Surah Al-Qasas was revealed most of it during the immigration of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam min Mecca to Al-Madina Al-Munawwara. And if you remember, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companion Abu Bakr as-Siddiq were immigrating because there was a plot to kill the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they went with their guide, Abdullah ibn Uraiqit. And the revelation here comes with many promises from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the main promise of the Prophet ﷺ as he's leaving Mecca is إِنَّ الَّذِي فَرَضَ عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لَرَادُّكَ إِلَى مَعَدٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has ordained this Qur'an for you, is going to return you back to Mecca. He's going to return you back. And here is the story of Musa. And here are the promises that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made for Musa and how, against all odds, each and every promise came true. The first promise that was to Musa alayhi salam in general, the general promise was that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nuridu an namunna 'ala alladhina istud'ifu fil ardi wa naj'alhum a'immatan wa naj'alhum al-warithin. We want to give our bounty and privileges for those who were weakened, transgressed against on the land, and make them leader of faith, and they will inherit everything. So even though you might, Prophet ﷺ and his nation at that time of immigration of the Prophet was in a weaker position, here is Musa ﷺ in a weaker position, and that's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has saved him. From the beginning, a promise to the mother of Musa ﷺ as the Pharaoh was killing the males from the Israelites, and the promise to the mother of Musa as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired her to put him in the river Nile, is إِنَّا لَرَادُّهُ إِلَيْكِ وَجَاعِلُهُ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ, that we are going to return him back to you and we are going to make him a messenger. And immediately he was returned to his mother. And the Mursaleen, that he became a messenger, came later on, but it came. Another promise to Musa alayhi salam as he was heading to meet the Pharaoh, in that they are never going to touch you. لَنْ يَصِلُوا إِلَيْكِ, they are not going to get near you. And if we go to the story of Musa alayhi salam, as we said, Surah Al-Qasas was not about Bani Israel, like Surah Al-Baqarah, for example. But here it was the life of Musa alayhi salam himself, the Qasas, the story taking track of Musa alayhi salam step by step. And the first thing, against all odds, you think that some newly born thrown in the river, more likely he will die. Not only was he saved, but he was saved and he went to the house of the Pharaoh. So here is the first thing. The second thing is he killed an Egyptian. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمِّ, we saved him from his self-remorse, from his self-regret, from his self-feeling of sorrow. And there was another, when the Musa alayhi salam made a dua, and the dua was, نَجِّنِي مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you protect me and save me from those who are transgressed against everybody, against humanity. In fact, Pharaoh was transgressing against humanity. Musa ends up in Midian, and in spite of everything he's going through, he sees two ladies in need of help, and he helps them. And as he is helping them, one of the ladies tells her father the story, and he calls him back. And from this small act comes so many benefits. Number one, ajr, he was given a reward for his act. Number two, he got a wife. Number three, he got an 8 to 10 years contract. But also, when the person in Midian, the father, be it Shu'aib or somebody else, he told him, نَجَوْتَ مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. The dua that Musa alayhi salam made, رَبِّ نَجِّنِي مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. And here is the father of the two ladies saying, you have been protected and you have been saved from the transgressors. Then, against all odds, he goes to the Pharaoh. The Pharaoh is the strongest and mightiest person of the time. And he's asking for his brother, and he gets his brother to him with him. And he is supported by 9 different signs. And the end is that the Pharaoh is the one who drowns and Musa alayhi salam prevails. And this is what's going to happen to you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You are going to prevail and you are going to return. And this is the promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the other end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us a story of for the transgressors, people of Mecca, people at any given time you transgress. Here is a story of Qarun. He was an Israelite. He was a very rich man that the keys to his treasures cannot be carried by mightiest men. And people who don't know the truth really were envy of that. While people really knows that these are just the hayat al-dunya, these are minor things. And at the end of the time, he was punished severely. فَخَسَفْنَا بِهِ وَبِدَارِهِ الْأَرْضِ He was punished severely. And the conclusion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, all of us, تِلْكَ الدَّارُ الْأَخِرَةِ نَجْعَلْهَا لِلَّذِينَ لَا يُرِدُونَ عُلُوًّا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فَسَادَ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ الْمُتَّقِينَ O Prophet Muhammad, O followers of Prophet Muhammad, O humanity, the day of judgment, we are making it to those who do not want to become tyrants on the earth, those who do not want corruption on earth, and the outcome, the good outcome is usually for those who have piety. This is the story of Surah Al-Qasas, its promises that are being fulfilled to the Prophet ﷺ and with the tracking of the story of Musa ﷺ. Second surah, Surah Al-Ankabut, and this is the story or the surah of trials. A trial after a trial after a trial. And this is what we go through our lives. And the fitna, the trials that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are mentioning here, the first fitna is a person who is a believer, yet his parents are not believers. And not only they are not believers, they are struggling and striving against him. They are urging him not to become a believer. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the judgment. And we know this for reality. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, his mother was not a believer and she struggled with him. Ammar ibn, lots of other Sahaba, Mus'ab ibn Umair, the same thing. And he struggled against his parents, against his mother specifically. And the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree is, وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ لِتُشْرِكِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِعِلْمٍ And even if they strive against you and urge you, do not listen to them and yet... صاحبهما في الدنيا معروفا and still stick with them and treat them with all the dignity and all of the good treatment that a son or a daughter should treat their parents. So that's the first fitna when the family are Muslims and they are fighting. Second, if the whole humanity or the people, أُذِيَ فِي اللَّهِ People are against him. They are not only against him, he's suffering in Allah's cause. And here is the suffering on the hands of people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are you equating that with the suffering of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of the day of judgment if you decide not to become a believer? جَعَلَ فِتَّةِ النَّاسِ كَعَذَابِ اللَّهِ You cannot equate anything that any human being, as bad as it can get. أعوذ بالله from that. يعني, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us. But you cannot compare that to the day of judgment. Then surah goes through the fitan of the Anbiya, speaking about Nuh alayhi salam, Ibrahim alayhi salam, as they take him and they throw him into the fire, speaking about Prophet Lut alayhi salam, Prophet Hud, and Prophet Salih, and with their people Ad and Thamud. But it concludes with a very important thing. In one ayah, it summarizes and lumps all non-believers in one ayah. Be it Qarun, be it Fir'aun, be it Haman, who was the chief of staff or the army at the time of the Pharaoh, or be it those who from Thamud or from Ad, all of them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, they were tortured. فَمِنْهُمْ Some of them we did this, some of them we did that, some of them we caused them to drown, some of them we did this. But the end of that, they lost the dunya and they lost the akhirah as well. Like when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the Pharaoh, it's not only that he's losing the dunya and losing the akhirah, even in the barzakh, النَّارُ يُعْرَضُونَ till the day of judgment. Each and every day they are passing through the fire to see their destination, their destiny. وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَ And then day of judgment, يُعْرَضُونَ إِلَى شَدَّ الْعَذَابِ Then they are going to be severely tortured at the day of judgment. In the middle of that, we hear the name Al-Ankabut, the spider, which the name of the surah comes from. And this is a parable that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us. And it's a very, very wonderful parable. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the likeness of those who took awliya, who are having, aligning themselves with other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be it their power, be it their money, be it their job, be it their family lineage, whatever that is, that they depend on that rather than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be it whatever idols they worship. Aside from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are not worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they depend on something. And they take this as their awliya. They take that as their supporters. It's like Al-Ankabut, the spider, who had a house. And this is one of the weakest houses. And we look at the parable here. Number one, the spider has a web. And the web has lots of arms here and there, here and there. And a person who's in the midst of this trial, he feels that he's surrounded from all these directions by this web. But you can easily break this web. You can easily get out of those. Although they stretch far and away, you can easily get rid of that. But another characteristic thing about the spider is their life cycle. The female, and Takhadat Bait, we're speaking about a female spider. The female spider kills the male spider. And when her offsprings grow, they kill the mother. So it's a house that is very weak from all sides. It's weak socially, it's weak ethically, it's weak from each and every direction. These are the likeness of people who decide to have supporter aside from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever that supporter is. How do we get ourselves out of these trials? Like in Surah Al-Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us solution about this. Here again, we have solution. Number one, اتلو ما أوحي إليك من الكتاب. Recite the Quran, understand the Quran. Work with the Quran, ponders upon the Quran. أقم الصلاة, establish prayer. ذكر الله أكبر, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember death, كل نفس ذائقة الموت, each and everything. ثم إلينا ترجعون, then we return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then الذين صبروا على ربهم يتوكلون, you have patience. And this is what Musa had advised his people. فاصبروا, have patience. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ told the Muslim followers for the 13 days in Mecca and later on. وعلى ربهم يتوكلون, and they depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and know that concept. Allah يبسط الرزق لمن يشاء. Sustenance is not coming from the Pharaoh, it's not coming from this person, it's not coming from that person, it's coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He gives to whomever He wants. So this is Surah Al-Ankabut about the trials. Moving along to Surah Al-Rum. Surah Al-Rum is speaking about the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done for us. It starts with a promise, and it ends with confirmation of any promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The promise was غُلِبَتُ الرُّومِ فِي أَدَيْنَ الْأَرْضُ هُمْ بَعْدِ غَلَبِينَ سَيَغْلِبُونَ فِي بِدْعَ سِنِينَ, that the Roman Empire was defeated by the Persian, but within 3 to 9 years, they are going to be victorious and they are going to win the war against the Persians. And that happened. In fact, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq made a wage before wages was haram, and he made a wage that is going to happen, and he won that. This is started with the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it happened against all odds. And at the end of the surah, وَكَانَ حَقًّا عَلَيْنَا نَصْرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, the promise is going to happen and the believers are going to win. فَصْبِرْ إِنَّ وَعَدَ اللَّهِ حَقٌّ, so have patience because the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always true. And then we go through in the middle, who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala identifies himself by his signs. Created you out of clay. Made out of you, خلق لكم من أنفسكم أزواجا لتسكنوا إليهم إليها وجعل بينكم مودة ورحمة. He made from yourself, your spouses. So your spouses are from you. You cannot hurt your spouse. You cannot make anything bad to your spouse because they are you and you are them. And the reason is لتسكنوا إليها, so that you have tranquility. وجعل بينكم مودة ورحمة, and he made among yourselves mawadda, and this is the extreme love, the showing love. ورحمة, and have mercy among you. And amazingly, the marriage is followed by خلق السماوات والأرض, as if having this marriage is more important than خلق السماوات والأرض. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the creation of the السماوات والأرض, heavens and earth, that we seek His bounty, ابتغاءكم من فضله, seeking the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the rain and speaking something specific about the rain, reviving earth after its death. And in that also reviving dead hearts, that hearts could switch from darkness and unbelieving in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to light and to live again with the iman. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing himself among all of this. فَأَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا. So stay steadfast. With that comes an advice and a command that stay steadfast in your way. Have taqwa to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Establish prayer. And with that comes behavioral thing. Give your relatives their due right. Give the poor their due right. Give the wayfarer his due right. حَقَّهُ. It's not something extra, his right. I'll stop on just one more ayah. Here, ظهر الفساد في الأرض والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس. That corruption that we are seeing now, here and there, in each and every place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, corruption has appeared and spread on earth, and that's because of what the people are doing into it. This is not what the intention was, but this is how things are. I'll move to Surah Luqman, and Surah Luqman is a straightforward surah. Very, very important. We don't know who Luqman is. Most of the scholars say he was not a prophet, he was a wise man. And it goes with raising kids. What do you do? And here he's giving an advice to his son. And the first and most important advice, it's like when we speak about Surah Al-Isra. The first thing is, لا تشرك بالله. Don't associate in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala anybody else. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وحده لا شريك له. And the description, إن الشرك لظلم عظيم. And if you look at that, ظلم is transgression. Shirk is association in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, somebody else. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ظلم is, shirk is even higher than the ظلم. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, we know more about ظلم. You know that as a human being. You know what ظلم عظيم is, extreme ظلم. When you associate in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has created you, have done this and that for you, has given you sustenance, has given you life, has given your heart, your brains, your eyes, your the sight, your ears, your kidneys, and everything. And in spite of that, you associate in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, somebody else, that's transgression. You are transgressing against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah, the Luqman proceeds and it tells us about Qudrat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the might of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and saying, there is nothing on earth, مِثْقَالَ حَبَّةٍ مِّنْ خَرْدَلٍ, small as it might be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can bring it. Be it on earth, be it wherever it is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can bring it. Then he gives him some behavioral thing. Don't be arrogant. Don't speak in a loud voice. When you walk, walk in a humble way. After all this thing, the surah ends up with two very important ayat to tell us again قدره الله سبحانه وتعالى, the power of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. ولو ان ما في الارض من شجره اقلام, if each and every tree there is, living here in Virginia we see how many trees there are, was changed to pens, and all the seas and the ocean were changed into ink, the words of Allah سبحانه وتعالى will never finish. It's extended. Even though there is more extension, وَالْبَحْرِ يَمُدُّهُ سَبْعَةَ أَبْحُرٍ, even the seven times what's available, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala words will never finish. And then five specific things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has only to himself. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ. When is the day of judgment? Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. Even when they ask the Prophet, and he will say, لَيْسَ الْمَسْؤُولِ بِأَعْلَمِ مِنَ السَّائِلِ. I don't know more than anybody knows. The second thing, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثِ, and he let rain come from heaven. He can decide when, how, this space is going to get rain, this space is not going to get rain, that spot is going to get rain, this is not going to get rain. وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ, he knows what's in the womb. And we're not speaking only gender, male or female. No, he knows the destiny, when he was going to born or she was going to born, what's going to happen each and every second of the life. He would know before his birth, after his birth, what's going to happen, the day of judgment. يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ. We don't know what is going to happen to us tomorrow. We don't know what we are going to earn, what's going to happen in our life tomorrow. In fact, we don't know what's going to happen the next second. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ. We have no clue where and when we are going to die. Don't know when we are going to die. Moving to Surah Al-Sajda, and Surah Al-Sajda deals with the concept of عبوديه to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are slaves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Al-Khaliq, خَلَقَ, he created. يُدَبِّرُ الْأَمْرِ, he conducts affair. He has created you. He's created everything around you. He manages and conducts each and everything. He knows the seen and the unseen. عالم الغيب والشهادة. That's Allah. Who are we? خلق من طين, human being. You're created from clay. Created من ماء مهين, from a humble fluid. So who are you to equate yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You should be humble. And who is the believer? إنما يؤمن بآياتنا الذين يذكروا بها خروا سجدا. The believers recognize that. And they remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They remember who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. They remember who they are. And they will immediately خروا سجدا. And they immediately humbly will make prostration to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وسبحوا بحمد ربهم وهم لا يستكبرون. They make tasbih. They make tahmid to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they do not become arrogant at all. تتجافى جنوبهم عن المضاجع. They sleep and wake up, sleep and wake up, sleep and wake up. And they remember, when they wake up, they remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the believers. Who are the criminals? Al-mujrim. Nakisu. How do they look at the day of judgment? Nakisu ru'usim inda rabbihim. They are humiliated. The mu'min, he voluntarily is making khushu' and sujood and prostration to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mujrim, they are refusing to do that in the dunya. They come at the day of judgment, ناكسوا رؤوسهم عند ربهم. At the day of judgment, their head will be lowered with humiliation. With the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَأَمْلَأَنَّ جَهَنَّمَ مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. I'm going to fill hellfire from those arrogant people, those criminal people, and from the jinn. And we know the jinn, some of them are believers, some are not believers. And the end of the promise in the dunya to the Prophet, وَيَوْمَ الْفَتْحِ لَا يَنْفَعَ الَّذِينَ كَفْرُوا إِيمَانُهُمْ وَلَا هُمْ يُنْظَرُونَ. When the day of judgment, when the day of conquest comes, nothing is going to help the non-believers if they insist on becoming non-believers. I'm going to conclude with, in the next few minutes, with a very, very important surah, and that's Surah Al-Ahzab, or the Allies, or the Trench. And the surah has main theme. It deals with so many things. It deals with amanat al-ikhtiyar, the trust of choosing. You have two options and you have to choose. And you have to choose the right thing. And it ends, إِنَّ عَرَضْنَا الْأَمَانَةَ عَلَى السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَالْجِبَالِ فَأَبَيْنَا أَنْ يَحْمِلْنَهَا وَأَشْفَقْنَ مِنْهَا وَحَمَلَهَا الْإِنسَانِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا. We have offered that trust to the skies, heavens, earth, mountains, and they declined to take it. It was offered, they declined. It was not a command. وَأَشْفَقْنَا مِنْهَا, because they know how heavy that trust is, the trust of choosing. وَحَمَلَهَا الْإِنسَانِ, and yet humanity at one point said, I'm going to take that. I'm up to it. إِنَّهُ كَانَ الْإِنسَانِ, إِنَّهُ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا, is unjust and ignorant. So what are these choices? And from the beginning of the surah, we know that. One, when a man say to his wife, you are like my mother. And there is a whole surah, Surah Al-Mujadila, that is going to speak about that later on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no, they are your wives. They are not your mother. So here, it cannot be both. It has to be one. And the right is, they are their wives. So when you choose, you don't say that. Second is, adopted son. They are not your sons. They are not your sons, and you call them by their father's name if you know them. And with the example of Zayd comes, we know the story of Zayd in this surah, and Zayd ibn Haritha is the only person, Sahabi, mentioned by name, who is not a prophet, not a wise man, who is mentioned by name in the Quran from the Sahaba, the Prophet. Then comes the story of the trench, the battle of the trench. And this was in the end of year 4 after the Hijrah of the Prophet. And here comes people from Mecca, around 3,000, and they have people, tribes from Aslam and Ajga and so many other tribes. And they are there coming to Medina in order to finish Islam once and for all. And Salman al-Farisi, one of the Sahaba, he makes a suggestion to have a trench surrounding the Medina. And here is the choice. We see the munafiqeen, the hypocrites, and they are looking at how the stance is at this minute. We are surrounded. We are surrounded by 10,000 people. And here we're in the middle of the Medina, and we cannot even do anything. We cannot even, some of them said, we cannot even go to the toilet. And they started making Is that what we have been promised? ما وعدنا الله ورسوله إلا غرورا. What we were promised is just mere myth. غرور. It's nothing. We were not promised reality. We were promised the wrong thing. And here the اختيار of the believers. هذا ما وعدنا الله ورسوله وصدق الله ورسوله. In fact, what we were promised that we are going to be tried. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so many verses. أم حسبتم أن تدخلوا الجنة. Do you think you're going to enter paradise without being tried, without being tested? And this is the promise. And they are seeing this as the promise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them. So here they are divided two groups. The hypocrite who took that side, their choice. They were trusted to make a choice, but they choose the wrong decision. And here the believers who are seeing the same thing, saying the same thing, but they are making the right decision that what we were promised is the truth. And it ends this part, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنْ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet, His Messenger, tells you a command, you don't have an option. You don't have a choice. When we look and we say, oh, this is what Sunnah Rasul. No, we don't have an option if He commanded us to do that. If He made it voluntarily, that's another thing. But if it's something that He said that we have to do it, we know the prayers times, we know the prayer numbers by the Prophet ﷺ. It's not an option. This is an amr. Another thing that is choices, and here the Prophet ﷺ, when people come to his home, he would be shy to tell them, leave. They would stay in order to chat with the Prophet. Well, that's good. You're with the Prophet. Who wants to leave? So here is, they are called to come to eat and they want to sit and chat. But this was annoying to the Prophet that they are overstaying their welcome. And the Prophet was very shy. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لا يستحي من الحق. But this is the truth. Here is a choice. The haqq is haqq. You have to declare it. So we see that these are the comparison that we are having in our everyday. You have to see, are we going to be among the munafiqeen wal'ayadu billah? When we look around us and we see how things are, they look bad. They look bad. And everybody is afraid. Even the mu'mineen, the trench battle, they were afraid. Zulzilu zilzalan shadida. They were shaken very tough. But in spite of that, they know that the deen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be going to prevail. While the non-believers, they think that this is just a myth, it's not going to happen. Not only that, they would come, فَإِذَا ذَهَبَ الْخَوْفِ, when they are not afraid anymore, سَلَقُوكُمْ بِأَلْسِنَةٍ حِدَادٍ. They use the sharp tongue in order to say, oh, look what happened to you, this and that. The surah ends with solutions for us. اذكر الله وسبحوا بكرة, that we have to make تسبيح الله سبحانه وتعالى بكرة وأصيلة. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي, يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. This is a command. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger, they are making salat on the Prophet. يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. يا أيها الذين آمنوا, you who believe, اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا. Have always, be mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, have taqwa Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and say always the appropriate and right things. And it concludes, إن عرضنا الأمانة على السماوات والأرض والجبال فأبينا نحملنا وحمل الإنسان إنه كان ظلوما جهولا. We have offered the trust to all these creation and the human being took it. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من فتنة النار وعذابها يا رب العالمين. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من فتنة القبر وفتنة الغنى وفتنة الفقر. اللهم يا رب اغسل خطايانا بالماء والثلج والبرد يا رب العالمين. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا يا رب العالمين. اللهم انك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم انك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم انك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم آتنا في الدنيا حسنه وفي الاخره حسنه وقنا عذاب النار. وكل عام وانتم بخير. We're in the last 10 days of Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all your fasting and all your good deeds. جزاكم الله كل خير. والسلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته.